welcome to our very special municipal election night episode of Born Under Punches, show where Kelly and I consistently humiliate ourselves and each other on camera in order to fulfill our fantasies and fetishes. This is a very special episode tonight because Kelly, as you guys all know, has a very specific fetish where he likes being mocked for his political opinions. So why don't you come on out, Kelly, and hit us with your very worst political opinion so that we can all give you shit for it.
I would love to hear my worst political opinion. I do first want to have a discussion about the issues, because we need to understand what the issues are to understand my opinion.
Right.
And the issues for me is that my main issue is whenever I play these carefully created videos in StreamYard that I've, you know, sort of animated, there's just this incredible lag to them where they don't actually like move as intended. And you know, I've said this before in our last few episodes, but this is the kind of issue I have not heard a single candidate talking about.
That's a fair point. We should have been grilling our city council candidates on that one last time that we were on.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder what Giselle would have to say about that.
Yeah, so my worst political opinion, though, since we're coming out right out with it, like, I don't know, can you give me a more specific category?
Sure. Let's go, like, what's your worst fiscal opinion? You're like, your most embarrassing one, specifically related to economics.
Yeah, so this one is complicated. So I, like, consistently vote for candidates who will raise, you know, taxes and who will like put us into more debt and all these things, not because I believe in like the social outcomes of these hikes, and not because, you know, I have kind of like a grand scheme plan for how that's going to like actually improve our station economically. In fact, I really try to suss out candidates that will increase taxes and spending, but will actually, if anything, reduce quality and amount of services, because for me, politics is just about being fin-dommed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. Well, and that kind of all fits in with your humiliation fetish that we've already touched on there, so that makes a lot of sense. Mm. What is it specifically like that you like about being taxed so much, would you say? Like, is it knowing that the money isn't going to like go to better other people's lives, or is it like, do you have like any sort of fantasies about what happens to your money after it's taxed? Like, you have fantasies of like Jason Kenney like rubbing it on his balls and then lighting it on fire, or or do you like, you know, dumping it into a vat of oil and then lighting that on fire while jerking off to the thought of the planet burning to death under climate change?
Well, I did feel something when you posed the idea of Jason Kenney taking my money, rubbing it as balls and lighting it on fire. Was that it?
That was it, yeah.
I think there's something there. I'm not sure that's the order I would go for, but there is like a there is the seed of an idea there, so I do like that.
Okay.
But makes sense. I mean, as we have absolutely unequivocally stated on our show before, I'll bring up our show's official policy here. And yes. Yeah, and I would say based on that, you know, it's not the cause of my desire to be fin-dommed, but Trudeau being bae is not entirely why, but it is, it's really brought my fin subbiness to an entirely new level, I would say.
Okay. In what way?
In that, first off, there's new levels of humiliation. So there's the, you know, me, you know, with everyone collectively, but when I look at the TV, I feel like he's looking right at me. But all of us saying, like,
I get that.
Oh yeah. Oh, please, Daddy, can we have electoral reform? And he says, oh yeah, oh yeah. I'm gonna give you electoral reform. And you know, we're just kind of like being edged up to having electoral reform. Right. And but then at the end, we're denied it, right? Mm-hmm. And then not the kind of denial where you eventually get edged up to it, as far mm-hmm. as I know, and you get to have your payoff. It's that kind of electoral reform denial where you just never get it, and that's like the kink itself.
Yeah, I think
at least from that person.
Yeah, I would compare it to those videos where you know, it's you're being edged up to electoral reform. You continue to be edged up, and then just as you think that you're about to get electoral reform, he just punches you right in the balls several times to stop you from getting electoral reform, but like also like gives you that nice painful shock of, this is never happening, it was never going to happen, it's totally out of my control. That feeling of like real hopelessness and helplessness in it, I think, is where what gets me off. But
mm-hmm. Well, it's a Zen thing, you know. I was just listening to my Zen podcasts while framing today, as one does, and I was, you know, kind of being reminded that, like, you know, the wisest of the, you know, Buddhist sages and monks are very adept at saying, you know, like, thank you also for the suffering, thank you for the struggle, because that is what it's, you can't have the light without the suffering. Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. As we've kind of seen with stuff like this, you can even just have the suffering without the light, which is extra cool, because that's my understanding of Buddhism from listening to kind of like spiritually dabbling white guys talk about it, is that really you just want to suffer, and at the end of it you say thank you and don't ask too many questions why. So yeah, I think that's, you know, it's like, it's not the fact that we were, you know, we got consistently lied to by people we vote for. It's the fact that we're reacting to it that hurts us. And I think that's, you know, it's great to have these reminders every few years that life is about suffering, but it's the grace with which you move through it that really defines your well-being.
Yeah,
I didn't phrase absolutely. That as well as some of the people I enjoy listening to, but I think that's another hallmark of our show, is taking someone else's good idea and filtering it through something more obtuse to make it worse.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, along the same way in meditation, you know, that feeling of, you know, the feeling of not trying to change the thing that's bothering you, just like accepting it and like just taking it for what it is, and just being like, well, sure, this might suck in this moment, but there's nothing I can do about it, and just like kind of surrendering that. It's almost a religious practice, is the absolute all-consuming vat of pitch black hopelessness that comes with politics these days. It's a spiritual awakening in a lot of ways, I've always said.
Yeah, and I think that's actually what really gets lost in that discussion of, you know, voter turnout, for example. People are often saying, you know, like, why is the turnout so low? People aren't interested. People aren't participating. And what I don't think they often understand is, no, when I don't vote, that is active participation, because that is, as you say, that's the surrender, that's the accepting that what you can't change, and, you know, having the grace to live with what you can't change. And yeah. So, you know, when someone's like, hey, you know, all you did was sit at home and jack off and play video games, you didn't go to vote, which would have taken you 15 minutes, you know, it takes like 40 today, but whatever. And, you know, my answer is kind of like, no, motherfucker, this is me participating in the election. You know, I'm staying home for a reason today, and that is because I want to be domed by all the various levels of government doms we have. and simultaneously because I'm extremely spiritually enlightened and I realize that me trying to vote is what causes the real pain.
Okay, so I think it would be fair to say that the official position of the show is that voter apathy is the true enlightenment?
I mean, that's not for me to say, because it is your show.
Yeah, well, I mean, you're on from time to time. You do, like, participate here and there. I know I do all the, you know, hard work in the background, but it's, you know, you're allowed to have an opinion on it, and I can veto it if I want, but, yeah, that's, yeah. I think that works for an official position on the show. Cool. So yeah,
if you take that agenda item.
Yeah, if there's anyone that hasn't voted yet and is like thinking, "Oh man, there's 45 minutes left. Maybe I should go and vote." I guess the official position of the show is no.
Well, I feel like the official. I mean, if I were to write this, you know, this document, this manifesto for the show, I would say, don't not vote if you're just gonna not vote. Then if that's all you, if you're gonna be lazy, you might as well just go vote. If you're gonna not vote, you need to do it in a way that just so thoroughly leans into the not vote. Like, you know, the example we gave was, you know, sit at home and acknowledge your suffering and say yes, thank you. Or sit at home and watch election results and kind of have this mantra, this I cannot change any of this, and you know, even but you could go a step further, which I hope to, with, you know, actually taking election day to go, you know, do something a little more spiritually awoken, like firebombing your campaign stations to actively sabotage the election, or really just to cause chaos.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't want to make it the official position of the show that you should do that, but I mean, you know, go out and wander and do something purposeful is what we're saying. Not necessarily that, but like,
yeah, because I don't want to imply that firebombing is the only way to disrupt an election. I mean, you can call in various threats. You could. I mean, there's certain things I don't know how they turn out, but it'd be really interesting to see, like, you know, running screaming naked into the school gymnasium, whether during an election or just, you know, during the day before when the children are there, you know, that could be interesting. But like, let's not forget some of the classic, like mailing anthrax to the polling station, although that is something you kind of have to plan out a little bit in advance. Mm-hmm. So yeah, like I'm saying, that's just another level of that hard work, if that makes sense. It's worth it, but you really have to be ready to put the hard yards in it. Also, you have to really make sure you don't kill yourself with the anthrax, because it's at least not before you get it into the mailbox.
Yeah, I mean, if you're gonna go really hardcore and not vote, I mean, killing yourself with anthrax the day before the election or the day of the election makes a pretty clear statement. So yeah. Who's to say what your spiritual experience is going to be surrounding the election? We're not here to tell you what to do. We're just here to, you know, talk about our experiences and things that we've done. On that note, do you want to talk about what the election was about this year?
Yeah. I mean, which one? Because it turns out you have one going on right now at the exact same time, right?
Yeah, that's kind of weird, actually. It's quite the coincidence. I heard that there was also a couple other elections going on today, so...
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay, so this is a true story. So my parents live out in Sherwood Park, which is, you know, a little, like, adjoining kind of tumor or maybe a cyst growing on the side of Edmonton, Edmonton has a few of those, but it's one of the most, like... pusiferous cysts. I'm not sure if that's the pusiferous. I'm not quite sure if that is the correct nomenclature, but you get the idea. Mm-hmm. And so, and I try to avoid talking politics to my parents. Yet it happens constantly, so I'm clearly not good at it. But one thing that certainly hasn't come up lately is the actual nitty gritty of local Strathcona County elections, mostly because they do not matter. When I voted in, was it my first? It was an election when I was either still living there or at least just still registered to vote there. I think it was when I was living in Edmonton and still registered to vote in Strathcona County. And so I think I extra didn't care. And I looked up, okay, like, who are these? I think there were only two candidates running for mayor, only like two that were, you know, actual contenders. And I went and looked it up, and I distinctly remember that I could not even tell the difference between their platforms, because they just said, like, let's keep our community good and keep on, let's try to, you know, strengthen our community spirit and come up with a great budget. Like, they were so milquetoast and meaningless that, yeah, me as I'm not even going to tell you what the criteria I ended up going for, but it amounted to a coin toss. So I basically coin tossed over who to vote for. My candidate lost, naturally, because, as you know, we discussed the losing, pain, suffering thing extensively. And, you know, even in an election where I don't care, I still lose. But yeah, that's the kind of like level of politics out there. So I don't think it matters too much. And I was helping my dad out the other day, and we're driving through and we're seeing all these lawn signs, which, as you know, I love and adore.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was my dad that first said something, because I see my parents from time to time, and I'd seen these signs, and I was like, well, Dave Quest is running for mayor. Like, I thought he was kind of disliked in the area, like, because he was the local MLA, if I'm not mistaken. I thought he was the MP, and my dad said he was the MLA. So he was in place at some time that I think like some energy corridor went through, and all the locals were flipping out because they were like, you got to bury the power lines, even though, like, because they were worried about like magnetic radiation or something, even though it would have cost like $300 million to bury the power lines. And also that doesn't stop the like magnetic fields in any way. And also the magnetic fields don't hurt you. And it was just like a wonderful debacle. So it was possibly was, in my perception, hated for stupid reasons. But I just had this perception that even among like the very consistent voter base of Strathcona County, that he was not well liked. And but I didn't bring it up because I thought like, maybe I could get my finger on the pulse of this. But then I thought, no, that's just like an intentional political discussion with my parents, and never mind. So I believe what happened was we were driving back from, I was helping my dad go get some firewood from this place. And we drove past the Dave Quest sign. And if you, let me actually see if I can pull it up here. So while I'm doing that, why don't you share one of your electoral kinks that we haven't discussed yet?
Yeah, absolutely. have you ever watched The Handmaid's Tale?
No, but I've heard it vaguely summarized, and that's enough to make me very vocally support it and all women. Why do you ask?
I watched it, and what I found it to be was a real sexual awakening for me. And so anytime that I
because
like
find you want to oppress women, is that right?
Yeah, no. I mean, I am a woman, so like, I want to be oppressed. I don't care about oppressing other women. Sure. That's not part
of
my fetish.
You can definitely be a woman who oppresses others. I mean, there's all kinds of ways you can do it, you know.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah, look at all the women and all the women politicians in the states that are supporting all the anti-abortion laws. You can definitely find ways to oppress other women no matter what. But I'm just saying that's not particularly my fetish. Like, if I'm going to do that, all the better. But like, mostly I just really have a need to be oppressed myself. Yeah. So I find
and I was,
like
I was going to throw out as an example, I was going to throw Betsy DeVos so I would look smart as a name. But then I always thought, you know what, let's not go down the obvious road of constantly citing American politics, which we all know entirely too much about. And then you opened it up. So yeah, that would be one example. Who else sucks? God, there's so many of them down there. No, you're right. We shouldn't get off track. Go back to what you're saying.
Basically any like ultra right group, anyone that cites you know, the Bible and you know, traditional gender roles in their platform. Specifically, I really enjoy people that talk about getting back to the way things were. That phrase itself really gets me going. Talking about how women in the workplace is ruining families. This is, I guess, mostly flashbacks to my church days, which might have something about why this was awakened in me. But so basically just any like regressive at all. Oh.
What?
You just throwing your socks on the floor?
Well, yeah, I've decided that if we're going to put in the time tonight after I spent all that time standing in a voting line, which has basically never really happened before these last two elections. Maybe because I was always voting in the suburbs and because... No, not even. I had some normal votes outside of the suburbs too. Anyway, I decided that a large part of the content tonight was going to be me changing out of my nasty work clothes and into clean clothes, and also making a pizza, which I succeeded in turning the oven on a half hour ago.
That's so, yeah, step one.
Yep.
Neat. Do you want to go throw the pizza in? We can all watch.
I'm going to see what... dirty my pants are. All right, I'll be back. While I'm gone, why don't you talk about, I don't know, just shit talk me for a while.
Okay. So, as you guys all know, Kelly is a piece of shit. He has no regard for his viewers. He takes off his dirty socks in front of us. He chose his right to vote over his obligation to his fans today. That's why he was so late. He has terrible political opinions. I'm running out of things.
How'd that go?
I ran out of things. I apparently don't hate you as much as I pretend to on camera.
I feel like I heard your ums from across the room, which was kind of funny.
Good.
Yeah, you gotta have more go-to like gimmicks, you know? Like that finger-tutting thing you were doing on the episode with Emily Missed Out. That was a great time filler.
Good. Yeah, I'll work on that. Yeah.
So let's talk about Dave Quest. So
yes.
All right. So
look at him with his dog. He's a Bowser.
Sure. What is a Bowser? What does that mean?
Someone that looks like their dog.
What is that from something?
Yeah, it was from a movie. I think it was
the Mario Brothers movie?
Yes. No, I think the initial joke was in what's that Jason Segel movie with I Love You Man.
Jason Segel.
Mm-hmm.
Is this like a relative of like Steven Segel?
Oh God, I hope not. Jason Segel's a precious little angel. If he's related to that monster, I don't want to know.
I've never heard of Jason Segel, like Segal.
Yes, you've never heard of Jason Segel?
Not as such, no.
Is that not how you pronounce it? Is that what you're giggling at?
Well, it's not how you spell it. So,
What do you mean it's not how you spell it?
Yeah. Oh, you're about to get Mandela affected. Here, I'm only have to leave the press for a minute.
How would you pronounce it?
So okay, wait, hold on. Okay, so it's spelled S-E-G-E-L.
Is it?
What? Is it what?
Is it it's spelled that way?
Yeah.
No. Oh, I did just get Mandela affected.
Yeah. So
can't be the only person that's heard that way.
Maybe. There are some Seagulls out there, but I believe his name is definitely pronounced Seagull.
Okay, well, Jason Seagull.
Do seagulls make pigeon noises? I've always felt like they're the same bird. This has really been like gnawing at my soul since I was very young. I don't understand the difference.
I believe it's one of those situations where like the female of the species looks different than the male. Because they're both disease carrying, food stealing monsters. So
okay, so here's what happened. I went to Wikipedia so I could go open his Wikipedia page because for some reason I decided to get really drilled down on this like insane see now I don't know how to pronounce the word pedantry or pedantry. So now I've completely been hoisted by my own petard here.
hoisted by your own what now?
Well, it's either, well, first off, it's a French word. It's pétard. So it's either like petard or petard, depending who you ask.
Okay.
And you get hoisted by it.
Oh, okay.
So
I believe you.
Yeah. Are you not familiar with the phrase hoisted by my own petard?
No, I use it frequently, actually. I was thrown off by your pronunciation.
Wait, how do you pronounce it?
Well, I mean, clearly I feel like the common one is petard. Because most people like to say the word pee. Yeah. Please continue. I let's just talk about Dave Quest. What are you showing me right now?
Well, we've gone on a lot of tangents here and I'm trying to remember which web we're in, but I mean, maybe petard just makes it sound like less of a slur, like you're going to be less misheard.
I don't know. I feel like it still sounds pretty bad.
Oh. Well, anyway, a petard is...
You're going to piss off some Star Trek fans here.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's a... like a early form of explosive... mm-hmm. that you would use to like sabotage things. So like I think, or if you're doing like some kind of siege, like if you want to blow up a gate, you would like plant a petard and then try to blow it up. But you know, these being pretty primitive explosives, they were prone to, I don't know if it was an issue with the user, an issue with the device itself, if you can call it that, but as the possibly apocryphal story goes, when something fucks up, the explosive goes off too early and you're not actually able to, well, you might be able to sabotage a person, but you're not able to successfully return where you were hiding or where you came from.
Would you say that...
So the explosion hoists you up into the air and you've been hoisted by your own petard, something that you had intended as a weapon for someone else.
Right, so it explodes before you mean it to, which results in disappointment for one or both parties.
Yeah, although it's something that is aimed as like an attack in the first place that backfires on you. So if that fits into your metaphor, great.
Only in my fantasies, but...
So the reason is, and this is a great example of why this really needs to be a stage show, because if you put a computer in front of me, there's going to be problems. And I'm very liable to just get completely sidetracked. There's too many distractions. I'm already attention deficit enough. And this is a reason, like, not only that, but to layer it on, that I can't go to Wikipedia in general, or I shouldn't, because I will go to Wikipedia and I decide I'm going to type something in the search bar, and then I get to the front page and I see something like this. British Member of Parliament Sir David Ames, or is that Ames? See, fuck, we're doing it again. Pictured, dies after being stabbed during a constituency meeting.
Oh.
What? This seems like big news.
I mean, it happened in the UK, so no one gives a shit, but I see what you mean.
This is...
Oh my god, sorry, this is recent. This is like...
Yeah, this is the
I know, I feel bad for making that joke. This just happened.
I was a little surprised, but I thought, you know what? She's leaning into it.
Mm.
And this is... wild. Some dude got stabbed to death, like, just...
Oh boy, what did it say? Why? What happened? 25-year-old male British citizen has been identified news.
Yeah, so also I don't know how I ended up on mobile Wikipedia, to be honest, but there's a lot to read there that I yeah, I don't know if I have time to drill into this because that seems really fucking wild and not great.
So I guess in order to circle back, like, I want to point out the irony of, like, how long of a journey it's taking you to get to the point of your initial story, and also the fact that the guy's name is Dave Quest, which is really appropriate. Like,
Dave Quest sounds like a really fun game until you learn literally anything about Dave Quest.
Dave Quest. Oh, I hope David's watching. We can. Oh, nobody's watching. But if David was watching, we could pitch this as a board game to him.
See, that would have been a great kind of... what's the word I'm looking for? A counterattack for whenever David decided to try and call this show Kelly Quest. And I could have been like... Well, let's open up Dave Quest, and there's already a website, but, you know, I had completely fucking forgotten about this guy. And probably for good reason. Mm-hmm. So, okay, are we back? All right.
Yeah. Oh, so, look at, oh, his dog's so cute and drooly and gross. So.
Yeah, and, I mean, I don't think this should be the... I don't think this should be the end-all be-all of how I feel about a candidate, but one of the biggest, I would say this is like 10% of the surface area of his website is request a long sign.
Mm-hmm.
Which is not great.
That's and... fair. Can I just say my favorite thing about this website is that you can see in the volunteer tab that it looks like he has a wife, but he has chosen not to picture her in the main banner of his website. He's chosen instead to picture his dog.
Yeah.
Which I find very precious.
This is definitely something I was noticing. Although this could just be like his dog groomer. Like, he might be unmarried. I was kind of hoping to see. Okay.
Well, let's hit click his the about tab.
This is just the same. This is the main page. Okay. So this is a guy who is a pretty, like, I think just longtime Conservative Party guy, but he's arguing for clean energy, which, like, isn't a huge, like, wild radical position, you would think, but
mm-hmm.
I mean, I guess I'm a little bit surprised, although when it says, like, energy efficient home improvements, and I kind of wonder if that's one of those, like, I feel like I see these things come a lot where you have these clean energy initiatives that end up just being like home renovation subsidies, then it's like, oh yeah, this new shower head will reduce water flow by 0.4%, and also they use the subsidy to buy themselves like an entire new dinette set or something.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember a specific example, but I feel like there's a ton of shit like that. When, I don't know. I'm being extremely cynical here. Free transit, also can't argue with that.
Mm-hmm. Treat internet access as a basic utility and a priority for every resident. God damn.
Well, I'm starting to think this guy might be some kind of socialist.
He's a fucking socialist plant.
Yeah. He kind of ran out of steam yelling out free transit, and as he hit the T, kind of just petered out a little bit.
Is the eye even? Yeah, okay, the eye's capitalized.
Yeah. Now, to be fair, when you live in Strathcona County, which is this like artificial island of affluent people, it's not actually that outlandish to propose like kind of costly like government spendy programs, because it's just like you're just awash in money.
Mm-hmm.
That was kind of my experience working at the rec center there, where, you know, these are a lot of people who are very like, I would say, fiscally conservative. Certainly a lot of the adults I spoke to in my childhood were, but they, you know, they're just like, oh yeah, the rec center is going to spend like 300 grand on a mural. Like it's a land of contrast, to be sure.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, good for Dave West.
Yeah. I'm sure it must have. Okay. Yeah. He was an MLA. So the point is, okay, wait. You're right. It is here. No, his wife. Okay. So that must be his wife. So yeah, like
wife his and his wife son just got fucking booted out of the banner picture.
Oh, well, the wife sounds like a grown ass man. He's currently living in Montreal.
Mm.
Jack Quest. Are there any jokes we can make out of that?
Mm. I got nothing. Come
on, you got this.
I mean, if nothing better than Dave Quest.
All right.
Dave Quest, I feel like, is the most like average name. So
yeah,
I feel like
I guess I
Dave Quest has that perfect like pair, like that perfect opposition, juxtaposition of like something that kind of sounds like an adventure versus like something that like is definitely just a dude that like comes home from work and like, I don't know, hangs out with his dog and ignores his wife.
Yeah. And he'll promise that kind of that relationship with his constituents. Either he's promising.
Sorry, can you scroll down? Did it say, there's a small part of me that wants it to say his son Jack is actually him referring to his dog. Is his dog's name Jack?
No, son Jack lives in Montreal.
Oh, okay. Damn it.
Also, you know who really got shafted here is the two cats.
He has two cats?
Dave and Fiona. I could read everything for you. Dave and Fiona have two cats and a Newfoundland dog.
Mm. You know I can't read.
Isn't it called Newfoundland something?
Hmm.
Okay, so more to the point.
So he's a traitor. His dog's from the East Coast. He's not even from here.
That's right.
Classic Alberta getting the shaft. Just another politician moving in here to screw us over.
Another politician's dog coming in from across the country, from Newfoundland. Yeah, I bet you the dog left Newfoundland because there's no dog jobs over there. Do you ever think about how like quaint it is and people are like, oh, Alberta's not racist? And I think like we used to be, I feel like we're less of this now. But Alberta has such a rich history of racism that, like, not too long ago, we had a problem of, like, xenophobia towards Newfoundlanders.
I don't know what you mean by not too long ago. I'm from Grand Prairie, and that's, like, alive and well, my friend.
Oh, well,
they're coming over here and taking our jobs! I'm like, they're fucking Canadian! Like, this isn't even anti-immigration policy anymore. This is, like, something else. This is a whole other level.
Listen, those people from Newfoundland, they're sending the Newfoundlanders. They're not sending their best, you know? They come in here, they won't even do cocaine off the toilet seats in the fucking refinery bathroom.
Yeah, I bet send their whole paychecks back home to their families instead of blowing it on fucking liquor and blow every weekend.
Yeah, sending their money all back home to Newfoundland, spending it here in Alberta. And you know they got those big fucking families over there because they're just fucking constantly. They don't understand birth control. Like, God, I live on a fucking rock. I'd want to get off too, but piss off. Don't come here. their goddamn folk music. Like, get an amplifier, play some rock.
Yeah, all they do is hang out in their kitchens. They have their kitchen parties, and it's this weird ethnic thing.
Yeah. I think I'd rather live in the kitchen. I don't even have bedrooms. Like, God, use that money and build yourself a fucking living room to play your accordion in. Fuck's sake.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. So, anyway, I'm driving.
Okay. All right, so let's get back on this Steve quest.
Hey, how's it going there? We're just gonna go up fucking, drive our trucks up to the refinery. How about you fucking speak the language out here? Goddamn, we don't speak Newfoundlandese. All right?
This is Alberta, you come to my province, you learn the language.
That's right. Okay, I think I'm out of.
I can say that here. Though. My best friend is married to a Newfoundlander.
Oh, is that like, are they having kids? Like, your relatives are like, oh my God, what are the kids going to look like? Are they going to look like.
They had two little kids, and everyone was worried. They're like, is this natural?
Yeah. No, I'll tell you what, the in laws are fucking, baby's just been born, and they're already buying it little toy boats trying to fucking. Trying to fucking push their culture on my kid. Get your fucking fishing boat out of here.
Yeah. I swear to God, they tried to screech in my grandkids. They're only 6 months old.
I mean,
get that cod out of my grandkids' face.
Kind of a valid criticism not to give your grandkids screech, but. In Alberta, all right? This is an Alberta kid. I had a provincial reveal party when we figured out what the baby's genes were mostly from. And you don't come in here with all these frickin' hearing choker toys and your ice floes and your boats and your concertinas. No, I gotta get a real Alberta kid toys. Get them an ATV and an old gun and another ATV. An ATV with truck nuts on it. Yep. That's the Alberta way.
I just kind of imagine because there's such a connection between Newfoundland and Alberta in that way, I feel like there's gotta be a fucking boat out on the ocean in Newfoundland with truck nuts on it somewhere.
Oh man, that'd be so good. I always kind of I hoped the oil economic crash was going to happen sooner than the ecological crash, and that a bunch of the angry, the transfer payments people would suddenly realize they had to move to the Maritimes to get a job. Like, I find that really funny, but
yeah.
It turns out the fish didn't come back. Whoops. Anyway, there's nothing.
That's gonna be that's material for a fucking sitcom for sure. That's a very Canadian sitcom. That's Corner Gas too.
Well, what, all the fish stocks being declitted and being this harbinger of our ultimate doom because we don't learn from ecological mistakes? Or you meant something else? Oh fuck, hold on. Let me check my pizza while you think of a really funny answer. I'm gonna check in my pizza.
You guys ever notice Kelly's a bit of a downer sometimes?
All right, did you think of anything good?
The joke's still buffering, but there's got to be a so long and thanks for all the fish thing in there. Not my best work. Can you tell me about Dave Quest?
Yeah, I just have one more thing about Alberta racism. So my dad, who is Franco-Albertan, meaning he's like a Francophone, you know, he's born speaking French. Or born so into a...
It's not just a clever name. Like, your family speaks French.
Well, my dad's side does. My mom doesn't speak a lick of it.
Well, tabernacle.
Yeah.
As they say.
Well, no, not in, that's a Quebecois French. You know, Alberta French is a different flavor because my dad, who grew up, you know, in a French community and speaks fluent French.
Where is he from? Flair?
What?
Where's he from?
He's from a very small community. I don't know if it's a really incorporated community, but it's this little kind of like kick out near the side of Fort Saskatchewan called Lamoureux.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And I think it's just like a row of houses under like that big bridge they have. Anyway. Mm-hmm. So anyway, at some point there was, I don't know, some discussion of people from Quebec, and my dad was like, oh yeah, those damn pea soupers. Which is some sort of old timey slur against French Canadians or against Quebecois that I can't remember. I don't know the context of. I just knew it was a slur, like pea soup eaters. I don't know. I guess they like their pea soup over there. But my dad, one kind of French Canadian, was like xenophobic towards the other kind of French Canadians. He might have been saying it slightly ironically, but I did find it quite funny.
I find it really funny that there's just like so many white people in Alberta and in Canada that it's like there's just not enough people of color to be racist against. So we have to be racist against like just other white people that are like very close in culture and to our own. it's real special.
Well, it's yeah, I mean, I feel like racism is, or maybe in this case, xenophobia is the better word, but it's like it's just a gas that will expand to fill its container, right? It's just, it's going to happen.
That's a fucking depressing thought.
Yeah. Well, you know, because it's, you know, not to get sincere here, but it's in-group, out-group thinking. So you always, when you want to feel like part of an in-group, you have to create an out-group to look down on. So, you know, you could do that with, not even just old-timey, but like people did this with Jewish people. They, you know, they're still white and except according to these people, but it was like, well, yeah, but they're different. It's like an ethnicity. We're like, is it? But
yeah, that's, I remember learning about, I took a history of popular music class when I was at the U of A, and the prof was talking about the concept of race music. Mm. And he's like, keep in mind that race music isn't like, or like race isn't exactly what we think of it today, because race music included also Irish and Italian music.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, they're not white.
Yeah.
Have you looked at
right.
them?
Yeah, exactly. That's there's a fucking YouTube video that someone made a while back, like 10 years back probably. It was quite funny. It was called Diet Racism. And it was like basically like if you're not racist enough to like shout slurs at someone in the street, but you're like racist enough that you'll like fucking won't believe or support minorities when they say that they're oppressed by the police, or you like, you know, do these little things. But it's like they've got it like, it looks like people are opening up like little cans of pop that just say diet racism on the side. And the one guy says, you know, the Irish were oppressed too. And then takes a sip of it. And I was like, oh yeah.
So, Dave Quest.
Dave Quest.
My dad.
Dave Quest.
My dad and I were driving, and I think this was my dad's like own initiation of this. We drive one of these. So what you see here, I don't know if you can see my mouse movement.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that photo basically, I believe, is like that's what his lawn sign looks like. It's basically the top quarter of this website. You know, it's got his name and the photo. And my dad's like, oh, this fucking clown. Or, like, that's my extreme. My dad doesn't even talk like that. He's a huge nerd. but he was just saying something disparaging about Dave Quest. Like, oh, he's just some joke or a fool or whatever, right? And he might have called him a clown. I can't remember. But my wheel kind of went off in my head, which I guess turned the light bulb on above it. Anyway. Light bulb like this,
right?
Bang,
got it. Kate,
wait, hold on, stall for me. I'm gonna get my phone out. I'm gonna make this really happen. Okay. Talk about the things that you like about me. That's a nice change.
No, I got nothing there either.
All right.
Oh, so I think you have a very...
No, it's fine. No, it's fine. It's fine. It's fine. I got the best part. This is an uncomfortable position. So my dad is... We're driving by and he sees the Dave Quest launch sign and he's like, oh, yeah, this clown. And my brain goes, bing. Oh, you weren't even looking.
Sorry, there was chili in my bowl. Go ahead.
My brain went, ding.
That's great. You can control that from your phone.
Yeah.
That's great.
No, don't encourage that. Don't buy smart technology. It's all total shit. And it will all just become bricks whenever their shitty companies eventually go under.
That's fair.
The only reason I have this one is because Paige bought it for me as a gift because she's well-meaning. And I was like, oh, a smart light. All right. Because she knew I like colored lights, and I do. I just like manual ones because they'll last indefinitely. Mm-hmm. So now I have this. And it's a different color on every day of the week. So this is why it's this is why it's a different color than usual. So Dave Quest. We're driving by, right? So we're driving by and we see the sign and my dad makes a disparaging comment and my light goes bing. And
sorry, can you do the visual again real quick?
Okay. Okay, so driving, sign, dad, remark, light, bing. And then I kind of initiated that conversation of, oh, yeah, he's kind of unpopular around here for, you know, his policies or something. And my dad just goes on and he's like, do you want to know what my dad had to say about Dave Quest?
Absolutely.
Do you want to guess? Do you want to guess is what I meant to ask.
I'm gonna guess that he said that he his ideas are too spendy. He's wasting taxpayer dollars on things that don't matter. Who needs?
You're already giving way too much credit. Way too much credit.
Oh, okay. Was it because his dog is from Newfoundland and not Alberta?
Like less thoughtful, less informed.
Okay.
You're on the right track there.
His smile is too cheerful, and he doesn't look serious enough to be a politician.
You've gone off the right track that you were on.
Oh, okay. Is it because he's wearing a polo shirt, and that makes him look a little like he thinks that he's better than people?
Maybe. No. I mean, that might be one of his criticisms, but it wasn't the one.
So, is it because his last name is Quest?
No. So... Mm-hmm. He says this guy's a clown. I say, oh, it's because of all these things. And my dad breezes by me and goes, just, why do you got your fucking dog on your lawn sign? Like, but nobody cares about your dog. He's got half this sign taken up by this giant black thing we can't even see. Because like, you can't see it super well in the signs. I was like, what, you're just mad that he has his dog in the picture? He's like, yeah, I want to vote for someone I can take seriously. Like, nobody cares about your dog. And I was like, okay, like this is the pressing issue of the day.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, maybe my dad is actually just a master of bits and has just like been taking ridiculous stances his whole life with an extremely straight face.
Mm-hmm.
Like he spoke out against hydration once. And well, I made fun of him for it like recently, like a year or so later. Because I was golfing with my dad and my brothers, and then I think because I brought a water bottle, and I was like, yeah, dad hates hydration. And my brothers were like, but like, Kelly, are you doing a bit? And my dad's like, yeah, well, no, it's just that, like, it's not that I shouldn't be hydrated, it's just everyone's like too hydrated, like they're walking around with water bottles. Like, you don't need a water bottle to go for a walk. Like, you don't need to drink this much water. Like, it's ridiculous. Like, just
Yeah, so sounds like kind of sounds like your dad's bored and he's just like looking to pick a fight about things.
I mean, he has real beliefs. He's got, like, even a lot of them are coherent. Like, he thinks that the referendum question, or sorry, no, the plebiscite questions on this, you know, the municipal elections that we all just voted on were like very dumb because they were poorly phrased. And it's like, what's the point of like having a electoral plebiscite question on an election, other like an election that's not even a provincial election, just by the provincial government? Like, are you just trying to like politically grandstand over how you want to move away from the equalization payments? Like, it's just yeah, a bunch of like, you know, self jerk off. And this is a guy who I'm pretty sure is against equalization payments, but he, like, I'll give it to him, he does hate, genuinely hate, like, just dumb political empty showmanship.
Attaboy.
But he also just thinks hydration is overrated.
Hates water. Really, thinks water stinks.
Yeah, and he's just really anti-putting your dog on your lawn sign.
I mean, you gotta stand for something.
I guess so. And he was like, yeah, it looks like he drinks a lot too. And I was like, okay. He's just like beat red in the photo. Like, oh, well, maybe. I don't know.
I feel like, I like that, like, I can, because I can see where this guy was going with this, where he was like, you know, like, everyone loves dogs, they're man's best friend, like, having a dog makes you more approachable and relatable. Like, people always say, like, oh yeah, animal, if an animal loves someone, you know that they're like gonna be a good person. And like, I can see where this guy's like logic was coming from, and I just fucking love that your dad was having none of that. He was like, fuck this guy and his dog.
Pretty much. Yeah, he had a whole string of things about how he didn't like the guy. It's just based on, like, the visuals of a lawn sign. I don't want to completely throw my dad under the bus, so I won't throw away all of the juicy details. But it was, yeah, it was quite funny. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, so that's his big issue with Dave Quest. That he's, I mean, the guy's taken the, like, Tinder approach to voting. It's like, hey, look at my dog.
Yes!
Like, if not,
yeah,
me.
That's what it is. Again, like, approachable, like, loves dogs. That's a good sign. The dog obviously loves him. Like, he's showing it off. Yeah, absolutely.
What happens if I request a lawn sign now? Will they give me one?
Oh, it just takes you to the top of the page that's already there. Can I ask you actually, what were your plebiscite? Okay, so get me.
I live in the same province as you.
Yeah, no, but there.
You can request a lawn sign. Hold on.
Specifically for the city of Edmonton, were there other questions on yours, or was it just voting for the people that you want to run for city council and stuff?
Well, we had the two questions about the
electoral
savings and the equalization payments.
Yeah. Okay. So in Calgary, we are voting on whether or not to reintroduce fluoride into the water here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, everyone's teeth are, like, rotting out of their head, but we should probably keep them off. It's fine.
So,
yeah,
sorry, go ahead.
That's okay. There's basically three front runners for mayor in Calgary right now. And I was looking at the one candidate's page. Her name is Jody Gondek, and she put forward a motion that was like, hey, I think that we should let, like, basically the chief medical officer of Alberta decide, like, we should, like, go based on their recommendations whether or not we should fluoridate the water. And city council voted no, which Ryan has described as a democracy at its worst, because he's like, they're literally voted, hey, do you think that we should take the health experts' opinion on this? And they voted against that. But yeah, anyways, so we've not had fluoridated water for 10 years in Calgary.
Right. So here's an interesting thing, and maybe this is my worst political opinion. So I was arguing, well, I used to, believe it or not, I used to spend a lot of time arguing with people on Facebook, which is no small part of the reason I don't have one now.
That's fair.
And I mean, yeah, there, you know, being in hippie circles, as you can imagine, you'll get a lot of those like colorful arguments about science and the scientific method and all that.
Oh.
Yeah, so there would be a lot of things you'd have to be like, no, like the sun will not like feed you chocolate directly into your stomach or whatever. Or whatever, sure? whatever the David Wolf people believe. And there was, so I definitely had argued with like the anti-fluoride people because I at one point I thought like reality and reason were relevant in that you could say, okay, so the article you linked, which says that, you know, the some establishment declared this like a poison or whatever, like when you read what it says and follow the link and then read what that says, like it's completely not the argument you're making. It was that kind of shit. Mm-hmm. But one thing I found, because I've done a lot of like trying to research to argue with people on Facebook before, and what I found was like credible people saying like, so like the big anti-fluoride argument from my recollection is basically that fluoride lowers your IQ because they did some study in China that showed like a bunch of kids with low IQs, but it was also, it was kind of like those aspartame experiments where it's like, okay, but you have 10 million times the recommended dose in your in your like experimental group or something like that. Mm-hmm. It's a bit fuzzy because it was a while ago, but that was kind of the main like flaw in the argument of the anti-fluoride people. But what I found also was like fairly credible people saying, like even public health people saying, like there's not really good body of evidence supporting fluoride in terms of cavity reduction. Like it's a kind of big, and like the thing about the data about what are its other health effects, like on your cognitive function or whatever, like nobody should actually be using IQ for anything, but is not super well studied. So you can't say, oh, it has these negative effects, but you can't necessarily say it doesn't, because we there's not a lot of well-designed studies on it. Was this is me like remembering and paraphrasing something. But that was the gist of it. And there was this, like, I think some public health experts or consultants or professors or whatever saying, like, considering what a sweeping implementation it is to put an entire city or region's like water supply, or to put a whole like medicinal ingredient into that water supply for everyone to be forced to drink, there's a shockingly small body of evidence supporting it for such like a major move, and it really should be studied more. I found that interesting. Like, it's just kind of like a thing that seemingly we got thrown out. I'm like, this looks like a good idea, and everyone was like, fuck yeah, fluoridate all the water, and then like didn't spend a lot of time really following it up. But I don't know, I could be fucking wrong, I could be canceled, but I thought that was interesting.
Okay. Yeah, to be honest, I, for things like this, and maybe this is like shitty of me, but like for things that are like something that I have not, that I don't entirely understand, and something that I'm like not, like I don't fucking know about medical papers and shit. My like default is to just be like, what are the majority of experts saying? Let's go with that. So like the Canadian Dental Health Association or recommends fluoridated water. Actually, this is a, so I don't know, you grew up in like an established city. I grew up in on a farm where a lot of people drink a lot of well water, or in our case we drank like hauled water from like an underwater reservoir. And in small towns and small communities, I think because that's the case, a lot of kids drink well water, and they, like a few times a year, someone will come in, like a dental, like some sort of nurse will come into your classroom. They hand out these little cups of fluoride and they like teach you how to swish with it. And you swish with fluoride for like a minute, you spit it back into the cup and you're done for the year. But they specifically go out and like treat kids' teeth with fluoride when they don't live in an area that has fluoridated water. And also, you know, actually this is another thing I noticed when I was living in Japan is they don't have fluoride in their toothpaste.
Hmm.
So I don't know exactly how.
How did their teeth look?
Small. What's that?
How did their teeth look?
Not great. To be honest, a lot of older people I noticed they have the brown or they're missing teeth or whatever else. Which I mean, I don't know. Like that's a sample size of just the people that I noticed. And I'm like one person that lived in Japan for a year. So like, don't take that as like empirical evidence, but or I guess, sure. Or don't take that as like, yeah, don't take that as like evidence, but like, yeah, that is definitely something I noticed. God damn it.
Yep. This is going to be the thumbnail if I bother to edit this.
Cool.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. It's
it turns
I guess
out
what, that, I guess long story short is,
and trying to figure out the real answers is exhausting.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, honestly, I just defer to whatever experts are somewhat agreeing on at the time, which again like has gotten us into trouble before, but like I fucking have a Bachelor of Arts in English, like what am I going to fucking dig up that some fucking that some expert that's been studying this for years hasn't figured out? Like, I'm not gonna like do my own research and like fucking get to the bottom of this and figure out that they're calcifying our pineal gland or whatever. Like, I'm sure it's
anyways, calcium that's calcifying our pineal gland? Wouldn't it be fluoridating our
pineal
gland?
That's what they want you to think, Kelly.
Yeah, I mean, you can't just listen to experts on, like, the periodic table.
Yeah, well, really, it makes sense that, yeah, it makes sense that the calcification of the pineal gland is happening, because everyone knows that everyone in Alberta, or everyone in Calgary is super enlightened and open to new ideas, and has all sorts of mind-expanding experiences.
Well, we did an hour, and the polls have closed, and there are no results officially, because it turns out that it's much easier to get live election results when you have, like, Newfoundland 3.5 hours ahead of you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I mean, I guess we can always check in with Dave's dog about how Newfoundland's doing. Do they
Let's go back to Dave's website and double check. How do I share screens again? Oh, right. It's still shared. So there's, I mean, can we contact the dog?
What's the dog's name?
Well, you can fill this out if you want.
Post your message below. Oh, I have a question. Dave, what's your dog's name?
I mean, maybe so should we just continue the political theme and just have, like, once the election is over, just start having failed candidates on and be like, what do you think happened? Like, we could have this Breezy guy on for Edmonton. He seems interesting.
Breezy?
We'll look at the Breezy thing, but.
Chris but, Breezy. I'm just kidding. We don't talk about Chris Brown on this
show. No. Can you even, but you can request a line sign up here. Whoa, some fake-ass looking names here. Reg Derry?
Hell yeah.
And this Will Trebell guy signed up 4 times? This all looks fucking... Or do they have to request specific... Or, like, do they have to request different line sides individually? Like, if you want 4, like, you have to submit your application 4 times?
Mm,
Well, we're getting on a tangent here. So we were going to be looking at, and I, you know, I was going to put on the banner for talking over Nicole time, but apparently that one's gone.
Yeah, well, you don't do that anymore, so.
Oh, man, I spelled mayor wrong.
Dave Quest is running for mayor of
St. Strathcona County. Yeah, maybe from a horrendous, racist, rich people suburb adjoining Edmonton, but at least I'm not from St. Albert, which is like just slightly even more racist.
Mm-hmm.
Slightly.
Oh, speaking of racist, Kevin J. Johnston was still on the fucking ballot.
Oh, did you vote for him?
I mean, obviously.
I mean, he's incarcerated. He might as well be the... Oh, man, I streamed all my typos and shit, too. Where's your website, Breezy? Okay, let me type in his actual name. Ryan Gregg. So this is why he's not winning. Because he does not have a website?
Breezy.
Yeah, he's a retired busker.
Nice.
God damn. Okay. Again, you're going to have to stall for me while... this is going to piss me off so much.
Can I... I feel like I'm going to say something sincere. One thing I noticed when I was looking into who to vote for my city councilor was... It was a tough decision, and I really enjoyed it because I feel like there's a lot less partisan bullshit in city council, like, candidates. Like, a lot of them, I was reading someone specifically, their page said, hey, I believe that we should fluoridate the water, but I will also vote for, like, he's like, I will vote on behalf of my the people in my ward, the citizens in my ward. And I was like, and that was like the theme of a lot of the people is like, hey, here's my opinion, but also it's not my job to just do my opinion. It's my job to represent the people that are living in my, like, my area. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I would vote for. And I was like, God damn, like, where is that, like, humility? And, like, it was definitely a lot less, like, I don't know. I don't want to say less fun, but it's, like, a lot less, like, aggravating, or, like, it gets a lot less, like, of the intense emotional bullshit from me. But I really enjoyed that, like, city council candidates seem to be very, like, less about playing one side or the other and more about, because I find, like, a lot of people just, like, pander, and there's, like, and then also, like, obviously there's, like, some fucking, like, out there a-holes who are just trying to say stupid shit to try and get, like, whatever vote. Hashtag Kevin J. Johnston. But, like, I feel like there's, like, it's almost like as soon as you move up from city councilor and get into, like, the mayoral race, there's more bullshit and, like, trying to, like, rile people up. Like, Jeremy Farkas, like, he, like, posted a while ago, like, something about this is how all of it, your city councilors voted. And it was a fucking lie. And he got called out for it. And he never apologized for it, but he took it down. But, like, I don't know. It just seems like if you're running for city council, it's, like, lower stakes, and people just don't seem to feel the need to lie and cheat and play on people's emotions and screw with their, like, try and, like, play on their fear or their, like, shit like that. Like, it just feels like it's, like, this person, like, really cares about people, and they're like, yeah, transit is important, and there's, like, a lot of people that are, like, really care more about, like, or seem to care more about, like, affordable housing and, like, working to excuse me, like make the city more accessible and like, I don't know. It just seems like there's a lot less bullshit with city councilors. And I was like, actually enjoyed looking into their platforms because I was like, I can see where you're coming from and how you could be a good person. Like, I don't know.
I think the smaller of an area that you're running for, the like more likely you actually have a connection to it. Like, you know, you might, I don't know, move to a province to try to become its premier, or you might, you know, get moved to a particular federal riding because the party wants to run you in a safe seat, you know, stuff like that. But, like, I just think, I don't think that that happens with city council, even really for being a mayor, because it's just not prestigious enough to be worth it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like who is going to have this brilliant idea of, who was the one that was on a post? It was one of our two candidates. I think it was, that was Grisela's, which was Behisowin. I think that was the one where the guy, she was ran because the guy was running unopposed. Right, you weren't there. Right, okay. So if you don't remember Giselle saying it, then it was Grisela. I'm pretty sure it was. The more I think about it. And, like, I mean, do you, I mean, there was somebody running unopposed. If anybody wanted to be some sort of, like, dark George Soros-funded project that wanted to squeeze in on city council and get sent in from, you know, I don't know where I'm going with this, but like if somebody wanted to kind of leverage that opportunity to like shoehorn in some big business candidate who had no real values and was just like a front for Amazon or something, like they would have done it, but it's just not worth it. And I think that kind of feeds into the argument of why we should, in my opinion, like why we should live in smaller communities and have more diffuse power structures, because there's less bullshit inherent to it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not to say that if you look at other places, there isn't, even here, like there isn't, you know, problems of city councilors. And I think like Carrie Diot here is one who is like very famously like a huge redneck asshole or something. I don't know. I'm trying to remember. This is all based on like tweets from other people. But like, we do have those problems, and you will see them. Like, I often make this comparison, but I think you see more bullshit in a lot of, from what I see of it, American municipal politics. And I think, I mean, part of it is all the problems we have here are always just times 10 down there, but also because those candidates are explicitly partisan. Like, we have political parties out of our municipal races here, and I think that's incredibly good for politics. And what would happen if we tried that at higher levels? But
that's actually, that was the other thing I enjoyed, was looking into the candidates for the Senate, which, I mean, like, whatever, we can talk about how the Senate has no power and they're just placeholders, and how
we should
no
talk
way
about
that,
because I fucked up and forgot to research Senate candidates, and so I like panicked and voted for the Thunder guy or whatever.
Hell yeah, you did. Thunder
guy. I was
guy.
Like, oh man. And I couldn't even, like, because all, it's funny because all of the like right wing people, the People's Party, the Conservative Party, had their party affiliation and the other ones didn't. But I couldn't even like launch off of that. I was like, I could vote for any of these independent people, but I don't want to vote for like a weird chud. So I just feel, and I was like, oh my God, I have to be home and get do this live stream right away. So I shamefully just marked off the joke candidate. And I've just now rationalized that as it is a protest vote because the Senate is stupid, which it is. Sorry, you were saying something.
Yeah, no, I, that's fair. And there were two joke candidates, actually. The one guy ran entirely on a platform of, if you vote for me, it'll piss Kenny off.
Which, my
not necessarily true. That sounded kind of like stupid and self-important, but maybe they went to high school together and fucking this guy like shoved Kenny's face in the mud or something. What I enjoyed about it was that, so I looked into the independent candidates, and yeah, there's just a totally different tone to their website. It's not like, ooh, like the liberal assholes are trying to do this thing, or like, you know, the federal government's trying to screw us over. It just came across as more collaborative, more compassionate. Like, even I voted for, and again, who's to say that these votes count? It's whatever. But I voted for two doctors and a guy who's running. I don't even know exactly where he's from. He's a farmer. And he's like basically just there to represent like grain producers and like farmers in Alberta. And I just like, there's something about him that it was like not combative. It was not, he was like, yeah, like, I just feel like sometimes politics just like, you're like, politicians tend to go towards the like, we're gonna fucking fight for our rights and we're gonna do this and we're gonna do that. And it's like, they're trying to come off as like this like strongman thing, which I think like Trump is really like leading the, like really led the way on that. And then like, again, we saw that with Jason Kenney where he was talking about like, oh yeah, we're gonna fight Trudeau on all these things. And, you know, equalization payments are bullshit, even though he made them. And like, he, like, there's just, even the Kevin J. Johnson guy, like, there's just this, like, there's this insidious, like, combative, we need to fight to get what we deserve feeling to it. And I just, I found that the independent candidates were so, so much more relaxed and so much more, like, it just felt less like they're, like, trying to present this, like, battle between, like, good and evil and, like, this, like, I don't know, it just felt more sincere and less like some sort of weird constructed fairy tale in which they were the hero. It was like, hey, here's what I do for a living and here's the perspective that I bring to that and here's the things that I would try and talk about. I don't know, it just seems, I just enjoyed thoroughly the less intense, like, self-important, like, bullshit. It was just very, I don't know, maybe it was very endearing.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't know. This is probably quite a rabbit hole that we could definitely speak for 2 hours about. But there's something about what I, as I guess a partisan hack myself, would say is kind of endemic to modern conservative politics in a sense, where I think there are fewer people like, you know, I, in all honesty, this is how I would describe my parents' politics, is that they are like, they do have these particular principles, and often I like argue with them or think they're uninformed, but they like have a set of beliefs that they believe, and that's what they want to push. It's just like, oh yeah, why are we spending money on this, or why would we, you know, why should I listen to these people who are agitating for X, or all these things that are like, they live in a coherent zone of like disagreement. And what a lot of people have been drawn toward is this just weird, like, foaming at the mouth, firebrand, like screaming your head off thing. Because it's just, it's effective, and it just appeals to what like emotional thinkers humans are, rather than being as rational as we pretend we are. And that's, yeah, I does seem like it's become more common. I remember noticing this in, this was in the 2015 election, like the federal one, where, you know, completely outside of what the actual platforms were of the major parties, every major party, its website, you went to it and it said, here's our platform, here's our candidate, here's what's happening. And the Conservative Party of Canada, their website was like just entirely attack ads about Trudeau.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's all it was. It was just, let me go to your website. What are you about? Well, we're not this guy. Which, I mean, it's not that that hasn't been used in, you know, in some ways, a lot of the argument of that election was like anything but Harper, but you know, and you, you saw that with, I mean, Joe Biden being elected too, is like, what do you have to offer? I'm not that guy. Like, oh, okay.
I mean, to be fair, that guy sucked and that worked for him.
Yeah. Anyway, with too many tangents, but
I know you don't like, I know I get that you don't like talking about American politics, but can I just say my favorite thing about Joe Biden is I have no idea what the fuck is happening in the States right now.
It is
because
nice.
He's not tweeting out stupid shit every other day.
Yeah, it's good that we no longer live in this environment where one topic seems to dominate our everyday discussion for years on end. Certainly nothing like that going on right now.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, the polls have closed, and there is still no results we can look at. Did you want to quickly look at Breezy's website before we wrap it up?
Yeah, let's do it.
I'm kind of just wondering if we should just have Breezy on after. I feel like he would come on, and because I have a lot of questions about this website. I'll kind of keep it to like my top three.
Hell yeah. Oh, so that guy looks cool as fuck.
Quest headquarters? Is he working for Dave Quest?
Oh my god, this dude looks so chill.
Yeah, you know, he literally is saying it's not a campaign, it's a quest. That's quite funny. And it's just like a very 90s GeoCities website. And also like...
yeah! Oh god.
How good is this platform right here?
Oldest but youngest at heart. Definitely different. Arguably the best candidate. I like that it says arguably.
Yeah.
That's very cute.
Yeah. And then, so I have a suspicion here, mm-hmm. which is that the fire truck in question did not in fact have Breezy for Mayor stamped onto it. I feel like he may have photoshopped or even dare I say MS painted this on.
That's quite the conspiracy theory. That's something you can ask him about in the next episode.
Yeah, we'll grill him on it.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, there's an extremely grainy photo of him.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I'm all into this. But this picture that threw me off. So again, we have... I'm just not entirely certain that this bus actually changed its lettering to say Breezy for Mayor on it.
Mm-hmm.
I do feel like... I would be really impressed that the bus's lettering managed to go outside of its designated word zone.
Yeah. Well, I mean, also it's really, really impressive and says something for his campaign that like a city bus that's supposed to like remain impartial and not like trying to influence anyone to vote a certain way would take that chance.
Yeah, so here's what fucked me up.
Also, who is the little girl that's posing in all these pictures with
him? I assume it's his
granddaughter. That's got to be his granddaughter. I don't know, actually. Whatever. People have kids at
home. It could just be like this this sort of like elfin muse that is actually just like made of ethereal matter and just kind of like appears when he plays the guitar. Or it could be someone he kidnapped. It could be anything.
Mm-hmm.
So here's what fucks me up about this picture, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to zoom in a little. Oh, what? Oh, it wasn't letting me scroll very effectively. So now I think we can agree he's not leaning on the bus, right?
I don't know. How tall is he?
I feel like he's not bus height.
Data on that?
But my question, and this is what I was kind of split on with some people in the like Alberta Discord group, was, is he doing the Leaning Tower of Pisa thing where he's just standing 10 feet away from the thing, or is he been photoshopped into the picture?
I don't think he's been photoshopped in the picture, but I don't have an explanation for why he's posing like that.
Oh, for fuck's sake. It just seems like there's really, like, again, maybe I'm just going crazy from staring at something too long, but I just feel like there's very sharp edges all around him.
Mm.
And I don't know, because, yeah, like, in normal photos, I feel like you kind of have, like, a fuzzy halo with the background. And see, I know they're standing here because the she's casting a shadow, and
yeah,
we know he's not that good at Photoshop.
Yeah, if he was that good at Photoshop, he would have a better website.
But I just, but something about this is throwing me off. I don't know if he's actually there, and it's gonna keep me up until we can get Breezy on our show.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, if Kelly ever decides to edit this and we end up posting this, if anyone has any input here or wants to know more, hit us up. We got the answers.
Yep. Well, we tried to keep it to an hour and we made it to 90 minutes. So do you have any dumb puns you want to end the show with?
No.